Good evening, everyone. I am Prashant Naran, and I lead research at Center for Civil Society. I would like to welcome you all to the 11th School Choice National Conference on Education for New Realities, Quality Education for a Post-Pandemic World. We'll be taking questions towards the end of the session, so please add your questions in the chat box here. We'll try to get to as many questions as we can. The School Choice National Conference is Center for Civil Society's flagship annual conference on education policy in India, and this is the first online edition. COVID-19 has wreaked unimaginable damage across the world. One sector particularly hit hard is school education. Schools all over have been shut for at least 7 months. In India alone, the World Bank estimates a loss of $400 billion due to school closures. These closures have adversely affected nearly 320 million students. Long-term impact on learning outcomes is still underdetermined. Over the course of today and tomorrow, through three panel discussions, we'll discuss how we make our regulatory framework accommodate and adapt to these changing realities. We are honored to begin the SCNC with a keynote address on governance for quality education by Professor Geeta Gandhi Kingdon. Professor Geeta Gandhi Kingdon is professor at the UCL Institute of Education, University College London, where she holds the chair of Education Economics and International Development. Prior to this, she worked for 10 years at the Department of Economics, University of Oxford. She's also the president, City Montessori School, Lucknow. Professor Kingdon's interests are centered in economics of education, and her geographical area of research has been mostly the countries of South Asia, where she has researched school effectiveness, the determinants of school achievement, the role of private and public schools, the relative effectiveness of contract and regular teachers, gender bias in within household allocation of education expenditure, the labor market outcomes of education, and the political economy of education, including the role of teacher union. So Professor Kingdon, I hand over to you now. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Prashant. It's a pleasure to be at this conference again. And this annual feature of the Center for Civil Society is the fact that it's such an enduring conference shows the tenacity and the commitment of the organizers for what it stands, for what this conference stands. And I think it's perceived usefulness by the groups that partake of its deliberations year after year. I'm really glad to have been asked by Parth because, you know, for an academic, it's really wonderful to be able to share one's research findings and they're not then gathering dust on sort of library bookshelves alone. And one hopes that they have some sort of an impact. If you permit, I will share my screen because I have a presentation through which I'm going to be doing my talk. And I propose to take about, maybe 35 minutes over it and then have hopefully lots of questions because I think that we all take back more when there's an opportunity to discuss the issues that are raised. So the topic of my presentation is governance for quality education. And basically what I want to do in this is that I want to show that governance of the school education sector is a neglected but extremely important factor in determining how educational outcomes turn out. And so I want to show that to some extent. And then I want to ask whether the new education policies, proposed governance reforms, do they fit the bill? Do they answer the need, the gargantuan problems that the school education sector faces today? Is the NEP's governance reforms in particular and the totality of the reforms, do they answer the need? Now, Governance, of course, means the regulation of a sector, the rules, the regulations, the norms, the standards that govern the conduct of a particular sector, in this case, the school education sector. And the organizational culture that has been, that has evolved in a sense by the state, by the state in general. Now, having said that, governance isn't really, is not, the governance structure is not necessarily always just a given. It is also consciously shaped by important stakeholders that have an interest in how they are governed. So teachers, for instance, are one important stakeholder group. They're not necessarily passive recipients of a given governance structure, but they seek to consciously even shape that governance structure in order to achieve particular kinds of working conditions, which will then impact the amount of effort that they would have to put in. And you know, there could be benevolent teacher unions which maximize you know, the same objective function as that of the parents, for example, if they are also seeking to improve student learning, for instance. And in which case, you know, obviously they would feel that they have a better idea of the input mixes that are needed in order to promote student learning. So for instance, if they ask for smaller class sizes or ask for higher teacher pay in order to retain and to attract good quality teachers, good quality individuals to become teachers, then, you know, all of that is towards a one kind of a benevolent teacher union, one kind of benevolent stakeholder. If they are not maximizing the same objective function as the parents, they give more importance to the direct interests of the teachers. They may be seeking to reduce pupil-teacher ratios or to increase teacher salaries for a different set of motivations, in which case we could call that a rent-seeking teacher union. Then politicians are another stakeholder group, or political parties are another stakeholder group in how the governance environment turns out. And they may use the education system to achieve particular goals, which could be aligned with those of the parents, but which may not necessarily be aligned with those goals. So what I want to show is that, you know, governance does affect outcomes, and ask whether the reforms in the NEP are adequate. I'm going to quickly take you through some data. I don't want to bamboozle you with data, nor do I want to dwell very, like, each of the tables seems to have a lot of information, but I don't want you to get bogged down in the information. If you will, just let me talk you through just a few basic facts from each of the tables. I want to highlight your attention towards certain facts. So this table shows teacher union membership by school level and school type. This is based on a survey that Rukmini Banerjee and I did in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh in the year 2008. And so it's dated data, but I'm not aware of any other data that has this sort of information on teacher union membership and teachers' political connections and so forth. So this shows that at the primary school level, you know, of course, in governed schools, you know, self-reported teacher union membership is of the order of 85%. But in private schools at the primary level, only about 10% of teachers report being members of a teacher union. Whereas in the secondary school level, that proportion is very much higher. Governed and aided schools, about 87 to 90% of teachers are members of a teacher union. And among private schools, also about 57% of teachers report being members of a union. And if you look at the last row, the percentage of teachers saying that they believe their union helps, that unions, teacher unions, help teachers with the problems related to transfers. Now, teacher transfers are typically sought, you know, not necessarily with students' interests in mind, but more directly with teachers' convenience in mind. And we see that unions are 53% of teachers in the aided schools and about 37% in the other types of schools report that unions do help teachers with transfers related requests. Let's look at the political penetration of teachers, because our constitution guarantees representation to teachers in the upper houses of the state legislatures. And seven or eight Indian states have an upper house of the state legislature. This information that I'm presenting here, excuse me, is from the Uttar Pradesh Legislative Council, the upper house of the UP state legislature. And we can see that in different years, going up to 2012, and I need to update this table with 2017 data, teachers as a percentage of the total is about 17% of the membership of the upper houses made up of persons who are teachers. That's an extremely high proportion of teachers in the corridors of power. And even in the lower house, the Legislative Assembly, 6.5% of the membership of the lower house of Uttar Pradesh over the years has been made up of persons whose occupation is teaching. And that, of course, there's no guaranteed representation there, but because there is a culture of political activism that seems to have developed over the decades with the guaranteed representation for the upper house, and the nexus between the teacher unions and the political aspirations have jacked up, so that even for the lower house, teachers are contesting election. So of course, 6.5% of the lower house is a much, much higher proportion than their proportion in the adult population. So then here I'm looking at, to what extent teachers have connections with politicians, even if they are not themselves teacher MLCs or teacher MLCs, are they connected to teacher MLCs and teacher MLAs? And we see the one that I've highlighted, percentage of teachers who say that they have met or personally know a teacher member of the Legislative Council. And we see that that proportion is the greatest among aided schools, because governed school teachers cannot contest elections under the quota for upper house membership. Only the aided school, non-governed school teachers can. And typically it has been the aided school teachers that have done so. And that's why we see, perhaps not surprisingly therefore, that roughly half the teachers of aided schools have either met or they personally know a teacher MLC. So that's an extremely high level of connection with teacher politicians. And percentage of teachers saying that a teacher contested the last MLC election in their area from either the graduate constituency or from the teacher constituency is about nearly one third of the teachers are saying so. And percentage of teachers who ever participated in a strike or meeting or protest organized by a teacher union, that sort of varies from about 68% to 76% in governed and aided schools, but it's a lot lower, about 20% in the private schools. But this is all secondary. When you look at elementary education in the private schools, only 3.2% of teachers have taken part in any such activity, whereas among governed schools, it is about 62%. Now let's look at some of the impacts. And I did a paper in the year 2010 this one is from 2013, from a paper that came out in the Journal of Development Studies that looks at the impact of teacher union membership and of teachers' political connections on student achievement. And we see here, and this is based on the same data set that Rukmini Banerjee and I collected in Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. We had students of grade 2 and 4, and we collected data on, we tested them at two points in time. We collected data on all their teachers who taught them and the characteristics of the teachers. Now, these learning achievement equations control for a lot of child and home background characteristics, but we are not showing that here. We're showing just the teacher variables, the coefficients on the teacher variables. And in particular, I wanted you to notice the last two variables, which are the governance variables. So whether the teacher is a member of a union, this is the self-report of whether the teacher is a member of a union. And the second one is whether the teacher is politically connected. And we see that in the case of both of those, there is a negative coefficient, and both those are statistically significant determinants of, or significantly associated with, related with the child's learning outcome. Both of them lower the child's learning outcome, and statistically significantly so. However, the size of the political connectedness variable is, the size of the association is about 5 times as high as the size of the union membership association with student learning. So in other words, these governance factors do impact children's learning outcomes. And probably more interestingly, when I have different, the table we just saw, here the independent, the variable to be explained is students' learning outcome. In this one, I've got a whole range of different outcomes that I'm looking at, teacher effort indicators I'm looking at, and I want to see how, for example, teacher absence rate for each individual teacher, the absence rate is determined by or is associated with the extent to whether the teacher is a member of a union, teacher union, and whether she or he has met or personally knows a teacher member of the Legislative Council, a teacher MLC. And we see that the union membership variable is not statistically significant very much for any of these teacher effort indicators. But when you look at the teacher connectedness with a teacher politician, we see that a lot of these variables of teacher effort are statistically significant, and the coefficients are also large. So for example, teacher's absence rate. A teacher who has met or personally knows a teacher politician, the absence rate for such a teacher is 16% higher than the absence rate of a teacher who has not personally met or knows a teacher MLC. Then percentage of teachers' school time on teaching on a typical day, we see that the coefficient on that is actually quite large, minus 0.37, but it's only very weakly significant, but the coefficient is quite large, it's negative. So you're less likely to be teaching if you are a politically connected teacher. Percentage of the teachers' school time going on organizing prayers and games, that's very significantly lower. A point estimate of minus 0.48. And then when you look at the last one, agrees with the statement that we had a question where we asked, to what extent do you agree with the following statements? And they could, on a Likert type of scale, they could answer strongly agree, fairly strongly agree, so-so, weakly agree, and disagree. And so we took those that said we strongly agree or fairly strongly agree that frequently absentee teachers should be paid less. Politically connected teachers were very strongly not likely to agree with that statement. So we see that outcomes are strongly affected by political connectedness. Moving away and looking at another measure of teacher effort, which is absence rates of teachers themselves. Now, unfortunately, we don't really have recent data because for some reason, such an important outcome is not really measured. There are no surveys of teacher absence rates that I'm aware of after 2010. And these two surveys were done by the World Bank. And we see that if you look at the very last row, the All India row, it shows a teacher absence rate in 2010 of about 24%. That means nearly one out of, you know, 25% absence rate, that out of every 4 days, the teacher is absent on one day. And in some states, it is extremely high. You look at Jharkhand, it's 46% teacher absence rate. In a state like Uttar Pradesh, it's 31%. So, you know, one day out of every 3 days, the teacher is absent. It is also, it seems that politicians, you know, another important stakeholder could also potentially use school education as a political resource. For instance, through influencing the moderation policy of exam boards, the state exam board. Here I'm showing the pass rate in the Uttar Pradesh High School Board examination. And if you look at the years 1988 to 1991, and you look at the totals column, the column that I'm highlighting at the moment with my cursor, you can see that the pass rate in the Uttar Pradesh High School Board exam is of the order of about 44 to 50% in that sort of a range, not a million miles away from that. In 1992, it dramatically falls to 14.7%. And this is under a BJP government where they put police at all examination centers to prevent the cheating that routinely happens. Now the pass percent, the percentage of marks you need to get in order to pass the exam is 33%. So this shows that less than 15% of all examinees that year could get 33% mark or more. So that perhaps is the true level of people who can pass the exam. And even then, and that's when the bar is set so low as 33% mark. What happens after that, what I'm trying to show with this table is that when the BSP party comes, it goes back up to roughly what its long-term average is, about 48% here. Under the BJP, it goes down a little bit to 40%. Under the Samajwadi Party government, it shoots up to 74%. BJP comes in very next year, it comes crashing down, the pass rate comes crashing down to 40%. SP comes back in 2013 and it shoots up again to 86.6%, the pass rate, you know, more than doubling. And 2016, again under SP, remains roughly the same, about 88%. And when the BJP has come back, it has fallen, and the reason why it's not fallen much more is because in that year, because before the exams happened in 2018, the BJP made a very big announcements and very elaborate arrangements to deter cheating. So more than 5 lakh candidates dropped out of the exam. Those who had registered, they never appeared for the exam. Therefore, the pass rate is higher than it would have been had these candidates who would perhaps, you know, otherwise have joined, had they taken the exam. So it's like, you know, sometimes some of the politicians or political parties may be treating it like a sort of a political football, or using it for expedient purposes. The diagnosis of what the problem is determines what prescription we shall give for that problem. So for this massive problem of school education, and we know what the outcomes are like for the children, the ASER data, I don't need to report that. The PISA test reports, position of India in the PISA test, international PISA test, I don't need to report that. There are so many indicators of from the demographic and health surveys and other learning achievement surveys. I don't need to describe the really pitiable state of the education sector. But question is, what are the factors that underlie this? And that diagnosis will determine what we prescribe. Now, the new education policy, the national education policy, the people who drafted it with extensive consultation and over an extended period of 4 years, they have made a particular diagnosis. And I believe they rightly diagnose poor governance as an important factor. And at present, you know, I think what the governance reforms they have put in place suggest that they agree that the government system is underregulated and the private system is overregulated. They notice that there are deep conflicts of interest. The government is funder, provider, operator. The government is also the regulator. Government is also the assessor of education, operated part of education, and a regulator both for itself and for private schools, and assessor also for both sectors. In other words, government is called upon to govern itself and to hold itself accountable. And it's just, you know, not something that stands to reason. Abhijit Singh in a paper in 2020 shows that in Madhya Pradesh, Abhijit Singh is, he was a DPhil student at the time that I was teaching at Oxford, and he's currently associate professor of economics of education at the Stockholm School of Economics in Sweden. He has written a paper in 2020, in May 2020, on Madhya Pradesh, where he finds that in a test in which the government, in which children scored 60% mark in government tests, the same children scored 20% mark on the same test items 4 weeks later in a survey that he conducted. In other words, even when the stakes are not high, in the sense that, I mean, so far as we know, there was no bad outcome that would have, you know, no vengeance would have been wreaked on those, you know, on those teachers if they had given the marks the children actually deserve, but they inflated the marks, it seems, by a very wide mark. So people are apt to give themselves good marks because they don't want to show failure if there is failure, if they are responsible for it. They don't want to show failure. So this is the conflict of interest. In Uttar Pradesh, in January 2021, this month, the Yogi government asked the district inspectors of schools to identify the dilapidated buildings in government schools. And, you know, in some of the districts, the DIOSs have sent inspectors to private schools. Again, you know, maybe to some extent wanting to, not so keen to always work only on the part that they need to fix. And I think that the effect of these deep conflicts of interest and this governance system is that outcomes are poor, costs are high, there is economic inefficiency and low value for money. A low return on investment, low value for money from public expenditure on education, and quite a lot of wastage of scarce resources. I just want to take you through just 3-4 slides, which try to show the wastage in school resources. Here is a table that shows the enrollments and the pupil teacher ratio and per pupil expenditure on salaries in government elementary schools in India. And this data is based on 21 of the largest states of the country, which together constitute 97% of the total population of the country. So pretty much this is data for India, one could say. Let's just focus on the last set of rows, last three, four sets of rows, which show the picture for 2017-18. And if we just focus on the blue row, we can see that that number of government elementary schools total in the very last row, you can see there's 10,35,338 government elementary schools in the country. Out of those, just over 7 lakh government elementary schools had 100 or fewer children. That means about 68%, 67%, two-thirds of all government schools were small enough to have 100 or fewer children. But 100 or fewer can mean, you know, it can also mean 50 children or 20 children or 5 children or 99 children. What is the average number? I've circled that number. That's 45.3 pupils per school on an average in these nearly 70% of all government schools, these 7 lakh schools. Average school size is 45 children. But remember that this is self-reported enrollment. The Midday Meal Authority of India, the Comptroller and Auditor General of India, all and many, many anecdotal accounts plus small scale surveys show that there is quite a lot of fake enrollments. And this is a figure of 45 average children in these two-thirds of all government schools, that this figure is an inflated one. If we were to reduce it by 20%, which is what the CAG estimate, the Comptroller and Auditor General's estimate of the extent of enrollment inflation is, if we were to do that, we get to a figure of 9 less than this, which is 36 students per school in two-thirds of all government schools. And the per pupil salary expenditure I have estimated and given in the last column. In the year 2017-18, per pupil expenditure on these 3 crore children was 39,312 rupees. And at the bottom of the table, I have benchmarked whether that is a large number or not. And in fact, the answer is that it's an extremely large number, that expenditure, because in 2017-18, that number, that's per child expenditure in these 7 lakh schools, and that's just on teacher salaries. That is equal to 34%. That was equal to 34% of India's per capita GDP that year. And it's equal to 102% of the per capita GDP of Bihar. Total teacher salary expenditure rose by 11.3% per annum between 2010 and 2017. So that's a furious rate of growth of expenditure. Now, another way of showing, seeing whether there is cost effectiveness, whether there is economic efficiency in the way resources are used. Teachers are, of course, an extremely expensive resource, the most expensive resource. So we do care about pupil-teacher ratios. The Right to Education Act says a pupil-teacher ratio, a maximum of 30. What we see here, if we could just focus on this column in the middle, which is the pupil-teacher ratio based on reported enrollments, which of course we know are inflated, but if we take those reported enrollments at face value, we see that, for example, in Himachal Pradesh, the first number here, there are 7.9 students per teacher. And you go down the and at the end, there is Jharkhand and Bihar with 35 and 46 students per teacher. And overall average for India as a whole is 22.8 pupils per teacher. First of all, the prescription of a maximum pupil-teacher ratio of 30:1 is not really evidence-based. It's not really in consonance with the international research on the topic. And we see that even compared to that, the figure is 22.8. The last column shows what I've called the cost-conscious PTR, the cost-conscious pupil-teacher ratio, which takes the actual number of children who are attending divided by the number of appointed teachers. And we see that that is 16.4. So in other words, when you take away fake enrollment, because a large part of the You see there the student attendance rate is showing at 72%. That means 28% of children are absent in any on any given day. But actually that 28% of so-called absence is not all genuine absence. A large proportion of that is children who don't even exist, that fake enrollment. So if we were to adjust for that, then the figure would be even lesser than 22.8. And if we just take the attending children and divided by appointed teachers, it is an extremely low pupil-teacher ratio of 16.4, given that we are a resource-scarce nation. And given that despite this low enrollment ratio, we are not seeing good learning outcomes. And I don't want to go into this table much, but I just wanted you to notice this last row, major 21 states of India. As per the MHRD report, the number of vacancies, teacher vacancies in India was 8.82 lakh. Right at the bottom, you see this figure in the middle of vacancies. Nearly 9 lakh teachers are meant to be 9 lakh teacher vacancies. Now, based on this, the new education policy says that there is an acute teacher shortage in India and that 1 million teachers need to be appointed urgently. That's what the National Education Policy recommendations said. And when I do the analysis using DICE data and applying the same RTE norms for the allocation of teachers per school, we find that the number of vacancies actually is 7,61,000. But and here's the point. Look at the next one. Excess teachers are 7,35,000. So when the National Education Policy suggests that we should have 8.82, nearly 9 lakh new teachers appointed, nearly 1 million teachers new appointed, this figure, our estimate of vacancies is not too far out, although it's still 1,20,000 teachers more according to the MHRD than according to the DICE data. But the bigger story, far bigger story, is that there's also excess teachers, where schools have got only 20 children. You know, they've got three or more teachers with 20 children. When you take that into account, you find that there are 7,35,000 excess teachers as well. So in fact, the net excess teachers is, you know, the amount of teachers needed is 26,000, not nearly 9 lakh teachers. And in fact, all of this is based on the taking the enrollments, which we know are overreported and inflated, taking those at face value. If we were to actually reduce that by some correct way of reducing it to the genuine enrollment, then there is in fact quite a large surplus of teachers if we apply the RTE norms for teacher application. Teacher salaries are high, they're extremely high, and they're grown very rapidly. Just notice this one figure at the bottom. From 2008 to 2019, continuously over this 11-year period, from the last year of the fifth pay commission to the first year of the, till 2019, teacher salaries grew at 13.9% per annum. This is for Uttar Pradesh. There is no calculation for India as a whole because each state has its own policies. But of course, the Central Pay Commission's recommendations are adopted roughly without too much difference across the different states. So they're not vastly different from each other. But at any rate, we can see that in Uttar Pradesh, over the period 2008 to 2019, teacher salaries rose by 13.9% every single year. And this is a compound interest rate of growth. This is not a simple rate of growth. So that's a furious rate of growth of salaries. And therefore, perhaps it's not surprising that teacher salary as a multiple of per capita GDP, per capita gross domestic product, is very high in India when we compare it with other countries. Now, this table is from Jean Drez and Amartya Sen's book, An Uncertain Glory, India and Its Contradictions, from the year 2013. And they report this. This is table 5 in their chapter on education. And we see that this ratio of teacher salary to per capita GDP of the country is of the order of 1 to about 2 in China, Indonesia, Japan, Bangladesh, and Pakistan. And in India, in 2005, it was of this order, 3 to 6. But The latest data that I have is for 2014 for six Indian states. It's not my data. It's a NUPA study by the National University of Educational Planning and Administration. It's by Vimla Ramchandran. She reports data on teacher salaries in government schools in six Indian states. And when I work it out, it comes out that that salary implies that the ratio of teacher salary to state per capita GDP across those six states, the ratio is 8.7. That means the teacher, the government school teacher, is paid nearly nine times the per capita GDP, whereas in a country like China, although admittedly it's a very dated figure of 2000, is one. So if China's one remains here and ours is 8.7, we would say that teachers in India are more than eight times better paid than teachers in China are, both in relation to their respective countries' per capita GDPs. So in other words, teachers are, public school teachers are extremely well paid. I could take you through this, which is a value for money calculation, but I think I'll leave that because I think I've made the point that, you know, here, this table basically, if you wanted to see how much value for money you're getting from public expenditure on education, you would have to benchmark it somehow. Because we don't have other ways of benchmarking it, because we don't have per pupil expenditures for other countries, so we can't really compare India's per pupil expenditure with other countries. So what I have done here is to compare the per pupil expenditure in government systems and the outcomes that are children's learning outcomes that you're getting for that expenditure. I've compared that with the per pupil expenditure in the private school system and the outcomes that you're getting from that. And that is the exercise that is done here, and it's a piece of work that I did for the Prime Minister's office in 2016. And it shows that the cost per unit of achievement is many multiples in the government sector compared to the private sector. So coming back to governance for quality education in this post-COVID world, we know that education has suffered greatly as schools have shut down for 10 months. Impact on learning is going to be a long-term impact, and it's not yet calculated. Many, many budget private schools have closed down. There is no proper estimate. In July, there was an estimate done by NISA on a survey of about 3,000 schools. Only about 4% of schools had received any kind of fee. So it was really catastrophic, the situation. World Bank estimates 320 million pupils are affected. So question is, how do we make our regulatory framework such that it accommodates these changing realities? And in particular, how do we facilitate the battered private schools, which are often parents' first choice? We saw the value for money that we get from the two sectors. The current regulatory structure is really quite choking in the sense that as well as the RTE Act, the Right to Education Act, there are 145 state acts and rules that govern school education in India. Each state also has a school code, which typically runs to about 2000 pages of educational governmental orders. And the norms are prescriptive. You know, we can see that in, you know, Bhuvna Anand and Tarani Sudhakar's paper of 2020 shows that educational legislation for many of the states that they studied shows that norms are not applied to government schools. There are ambiguous requirements. There are heavy penalties for private schools, such as withdrawal of recognition. The new education policy laments this an overemphasis on inputs in the Right to Education Act and also the mechanistic nature of their specifications. And it says that recognition requirements must be more responsive to ground realities, such as, for example, the lack of availability of grounds, playgrounds in densely populated urban areas. So let's move now to the NEP proposed reforms of governance. The new education policy proposes light but tight regulation of the school education sector. And it says that this regulation must be on equal terms for government schools and private schools. And it also prescribes performance-based pay and performance-based progression, career progression for teachers. New education policy wants equal regulation for both private and public sectors. But in the discussions of the new education policy that, you know, I must have attended many, many, many webinars in the past 6 months on new education policy, but I have never come across a single one in which this topic was picked up, the topic of governance. The topics that are typically picked up from the NEP are things about foundational learning. I mean, those are very important topics as well. But the governance aspect, the macro discussion, is not common. And why may there be a resistance to it or a lack of focus on it? And I think it is because turkeys won't vote for Christmas. If the provision of the new education policy that the State School Standards Authority, a new State School Standards Authority, SSSA, will be created, and it will, you know, it will supplant the Directorate of Basic Education in terms of the regulation role. The Directorate of Education would be looking after only the operation of the government schools, the public schools. It will not be doing the regulation anymore. I think it reduces the powers of the current you know, people who are governing the school education sector. And it will remove also their source of income. I think, you know, one has to be very frank about it, because there is a lot of income to be had from those regulations and from enforcing those regulations, those recognition norms. A lot of money is extracted from, particularly from budget private schools and other private schools for, in the name of not fulfilling those norms. When the same norms, when they are flouted by government schools, there's no consequences. So I think that there would be a resistance because there would be income to be lost. And they would also have to become accountable to an external body, whereas hitherto they've been sovereign. You know, they've not had to be accountable to anybody. So I expect that there will be quite a lot of resistance to the establishment of the SSSA. Then there's also the question of how independent the membership of the SSSA would be. In particular, you know, who will appoint its members? Are they going to, how can we be sure that there will be independence, and how to change the culture of the past 75 years or so? There would need to be a very deep commitment and a sort of political will to make a success of the independence of the State School Standards Authority, the proposed new authority that will govern both private schools and public schools on the same parameters. There is an asymmetric treatment at the moment of government schools and private schools. There are no penalties, as I said, on government schools for flouting recognition norms, but private schools are closed down as per Section 19 of the RTA. Can the State School Standards Authority address that? What about teacher union resistance? When you know, there are so many states that are trying to reform systems, and teacher unions, Uttar Pradesh introduced the Prerna app, and the teacher unions were very averse to putting in, you know, taking a picture with their students and putting it there, or marking their attendance on the app, because it would make them accountable. So how would the SSSA, you know, govern the system? Would it be able to apply penalties to government schools? Would that be possible? Then teacher salary escalation in government schools, as I showed, has been of the order of 13.9% per annum over a long stretch of time, at least in one state, and is likely to be in other states as well. But private schools fee increases are heavily regulated, more so in some states than others, but across the board, quite. Can the SSSA really equalize it? Should it? And COVID-19, the pressure on private schools not to increase fee, and thus. So I just wanted to go then beyond the post-COVID needs. The post-COVID regulation needs to address, of course, quality, equity, and innovation and technology, plus new age pedagogies, the introduction of new age pedagogies. The budget private schools that cater to a significant proportion of India's low-income population have been at the risk of shutting down. They are at a very significant risk of shutting down because there were no economic packages for them, because they're not regarded as MSMEs. So the question is how to build a regulatory framework that ensures that these schools also prosper and that they deliver on their promises. Most important of all, we need an implementation blueprint for these, and a draft school code is being developed by the NITI Aayog. I wanted to, in the end, to go a little bit beyond the NEP. Are the governance reforms of the NEP sufficient to address the massive problems in the school education sector? And will the State School Standards Authority that is sought to be created under the NEP be able to regulate using principles of efficiency and equity? Would it be capable of overcoming the sometimes unhealthy effects of teacher unions? will it be able to counteract the culture of political activism and influence, sometimes when it is in a negative direction, and the use of the education sector by some unscrupulous politicians. While in the rest of the world, public-private partnerships have been a popular reform, they do not figure in the new education policy. For example, there is no mention of direct benefit transfers or school vouchers. Even though the cost of education for a given level of achievement is, you know, an order of magnitude higher in public sector than in the private school sector, due to the high costs of government schools, mainly because of high salaries and rapidly rising salaries in the public sector. Despite that cost effectiveness of the private sector, it seems that there is, you know, it's a ideologically driven constraint that we shall not consider public-private partnerships. At the risk of sounding a bit dramatic, but perhaps I hope not exaggerating, the NEP's governance reforms, I think, offer a feeble prescription for the problems which are very, very large looming. If I was to go to some possible solutions, it seems to me, and you know, I would love to discuss this on this, that the first step is to confront the facts for what they are. There is this problem of emptying of government schools, and it needs to be urgently addressed. This is the reason why the, you know, in the 7 year between 2010 and 2017, 2.4 crore children abandoned elementary government schools, and 2.1 crore children increased in the numbers of children in private schools increased by 2.1 crore. Now, you know, this emptying of schools, which has rendered the government schooling sector very economically unviable, and of course, also importantly, pedagogically unviable, it needs to be addressed urgently. The new education policy suggests things like making school clusters so that resources can be shared between schools, but it doesn't really directly give very effective remedies for the emptying of government schools. What the options are, of course, school consolidation, as has happened in Rajasthan and in many other states by now. The other thing is to move students to nearby private schools with government paying the fee and closing down the school. When a government entity has been sought to be closed, such as BSNL, roughly 1,50,000 employees, staff of BSNL, were offered a voluntary retirement scheme. And a similar scheme could be thought of for teachers if they do not want to move from teacher surplus schools to the teacher deficient schools. Because as I showed you, there really isn't any need for new recruitment of teachers, new appointment of teachers, because there are teacher surplus schools from where teachers could be redeployed to the teacher deficit schools. So those that do not want to move could be moved either to other jobs, or they could even be removed if they're unwilling to move to schools that where they can still be teachers. And it seems that the problem wants central government's intervention. And far from freezing new recruitment, the NEP recommends, as I said, about 1 million new teachers appointment, which would cost 53,000 crore rupees per annum if we applied the salaries of 2017-18. So there needs to be a freeze. And as I said, there could be redeployment of teachers. I think there needs to be an honest recognition that the government lacks the instruments to really bring discipline and accountability to teachers that can dramatically raise their productivity. And if there is that honest recognition, then there would not be a resistance to private schools or to public-private partnerships in education. And the effort to resist this process over the last 75 years, what is sometimes called the privatization of education, the efforts to resist that have not really succeeded in the past 70 years. And I think it would be useful to amend the RTE Act in such a way that the 25% reservation for below poverty level households in private schools is achieved through a voucher to students or through a DBT, a direct benefit transfer to students. Just like the children's education allowance of 27,000 rupees per child per annum that the central government gives to all its employees. And just like Andhra Pradesh has brought in a direct benefit transfer for all below poverty line children, this can also be done. Thank you very much. And I look forward to questions.
Thank you so much, Professor Kingdon. This was quite insightful. And we have gathered some questions from the audience. One of the questions is, what impact will the pandemic have on implementation of NEP, and what provisions will be the most difficult to implement because of the pandemic?
Mm-hmm. The NEP was not formulated before the pandemic, so it did not foresee the circumstances that the COVID would create. Surely the exclusion of so many children from the school education sector is presenting particular challenges. And if the effects of the pandemic continue for another 6 months, 9 months, till the vaccine can reach everybody, there will be hesitancy on the part of parents to join their children back in the school education system. And so long as that lasts, there will be exclusion. There'll continue to be exclusion. So I think that what's really important is that technology also is made available to children, and teachers are trained in that. I think that implementation of, although the NEP did not really envisage the intervention of technology or the need for technology in education to such a great extent, I think that the COVID will have undermined the ability of the whole government apparatus to deliver even what they normally are able to deliver. But I think that it is also a positive one in the sense that it has given time to pause. It has given governments time, state governments, to pause and to reconsider their strategies. And I think that when it comes to the implementation of the NEP, that process will benefit from the fact that there has been an opportunity to sit back and reflect on what it is that reforms need to be and how to implement. I think there has been more opportunity for that.
Thank you, Professor. Professor, in light of the numbers, which policy interventions would be advisable to make teachers more accountable? Is there any way that we can overhaul teacher incentives to make them more accountable?
Yes, and I think this is one thing that the new education policy does, which is very good. The policy intent is very good. And what it says is that teachers must be rewarded if they are doing good work. I mean, basically their work should be appraised. There should be an annual appraisal of each teacher's performance, and the teacher's progression and promotion and salary escalation should depend on that. So I think that would be a very good governance reform. The problem is in the implementation of that, because teacher unions have typically, not just in India, but anywhere in the world, unions have typically resisted performance-related pay kinds of proposals. For instance, in the UK, when the UK government sought to introduce a mild form of performance-related pay, there was a huge amount of resistance from teachers. In the end, it had to water it down quite a lot. And teacher unions split over that, and it was then introduced. So I think that implementation will see problems, and that's where the real buck is going to be. The difficulty of seeing to the implementation, it'll require a lot of political will, it'll require backing, it'll require consistent effort, it'll require tackling teacher resistance. So I think a lot of work will need to be done in order to ensure that teacher incentivization, such as proposed in the new education policy, can take place.
Professor, last year has redefined pedagogy in ways that were previously unimaginable. How do you believe this shift towards new teaching methods, the role of technology, have impacted the quality of education? And do you think this new way of life can sustain itself in the Indian education framework after things go back to normal?
Thank you, Prashant. Here I speak probably more as a practitioner, in the sense that I'm associated with one school. And what we have seen is that in this pandemic year, when education has had to suddenly move to online platforms, benefited the children in the sense that they have become much more eloquent, much more expressive, much more able to communicative. And I think that those things have really helped children to learn in a different way. Also, they have become more independent learners. So I think that when it's also become proven to the teachers that they can also learn certain things from the children, because children were very advanced in technical skills, and teachers had to learn oftentimes from the children. So I think that it has been a very good shake-up of the system, but it requires, I think that the challenge after COVID will be that, first of all, government school children have not been able to benefit as much because there was a high proportion of children who would not have had devices, but also because teachers were not trained. Teachers did not themselves have IT training. So I think going forward in the future, the government would need to really place a lot of emphasis on technology so that the benefits of online education, blended learning, can be harnessed, and it will not be possible. Nobody would want to go back to only face-to-face teaching. One would want now to integrate both online education with face-to-face education for the benefits, the different kinds of benefits that both offer. If you think of Bloom's taxonomy, the first three parts of the rung, it's much better a sort of asynchronous, remembering and factual recall and understanding. All of those are much better done, asynchronously and probably sitting at home alone reading. Even flipped classes can be done that way. And then when it comes to the more, creative thinking, the collaboration, collaborative learning, and so on, and that sort of a part of the Bloom's taxonomy could be much better done probably face-to-face in classrooms where there can be discussion and debate and assistance of a teacher. So I think going forward, we need to do blended learning, number one, and in particular so that we don't lose the children who don't have access to that technology and the teacher training, the government needs to act on those two fronts.
Thank you so much, Professor Kandi Kingdon. This discussion was quite insightful.